So hello everyone and welcome to Neetopedia, that is Neetka Encyclopedia, and we are back again with another audiobook of physics of class 12th. So today we will be starting with electromagnetic waves, and why I am randomly picking up chapters because first hum log wo chapters le rahe hain jinke liye reading NCERT is very very important, and slowly and gradually we'll finish each and every chapters of audiobook of all the three subjects, that is physics, chemistry and biology. For now we'll be starting with chapter 8, electromagnetic waves. 8.1, introduction. In chapter 4 we learned that an electric current produces magnetic field, that the two current carrying wires exert a magnetic force on each other. Further, in chapter 6 we have seen that magnetic field changing with time gives rise to an electric field. Is the converse also true? Does an electric field changing with time give rise to a magnetic field? James Clerk Maxwell argued that this was indeed the case. Not only an electric field but also a time-varying electric field generates magnetic field. While applying Ampere's circuital law to find magnetic field at a point outside a capacitor connected to a time-varying current, Maxwell noticed an inconsistency in the Ampere's circuital law. He suggested that existence of an additional current called by him the displacement current to remove this inconsistency. Maxwell formulated a set of equations involving electric and magnetic fields and their sources, the charge and current densities. These equations are known as Maxwell's equation. Together with the Lorentz force formula, they mathematically express all the basic laws of electromagnetism. The most important prediction to emerge from Maxwell's equation is the existence of electromagnetic waves, which are coupled time-varying electric and magnetic fields that propagate in space. The speed of the waves according to these equations turned out to be very close to the speed of light, that is 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second, obtained from optical measurements. This led to the remarkable conclusion that light is an electromagnetic wave. Maxwell's work thus unified the domain of electricity, magnetism and light. Hertz in 1885 experimentally demonstrated the existence of electromagnetic waves. Its technological use by Marconi and others led to revolution in communication that we are witnessing today. In this chapter, we first discuss the need for displacement current and its consequences. Then, we present a descriptive amount of electromagnetic waves. A broad spectrum of electromagnetic waves stretching from gamma rays to long radio waves is described. How the electromagnetic waves are sent and received for communication is discussed in chapter 15. 8.2, displacement current. We have seen in chapter 4 that an electric current produces magnetic field around it. Maxwell showed that for logical consistency, a changing electric field must also produce a magnetic field. This effect is of great importance because it explains the existence of radio waves, gamma rays and visible light, as well as all other forms of electromagnetic waves. To see how a changing electric field gives rise to a magnetic field, let us consider the process of charging of a capacitor and apply Ampere's circuital law, given by differentiation of B dot dl is equal to mu naught it, to find magnetic field at a point outside the capacitor. Figure 8.1a shows a parallel plate capacitor C, which is a part of a circuit through which a time-dependent current I flows. Let us find the magnetic field of a point such as P in the region where the parallel plate capacitor. For this, we consider a plane circular loop of radius r whose plane is perpendicular to the direction of current carrying wire and which is centered symmetrically with respect to the wire. From symmetry, the magnetic field is directed along the circumference of the circular loop and in the same magnitude at all the points of the loop, so that B is the magnitude of the field. The left side of equation 8.1 is B 2 pi r. So we have B 2 pi r is equal to mu naught it. Now consider a different surface which has the same boundary. This is a pot-like surface in figure 8.1b, which nowhere touches the current but has its bottom between the capacitor plates. Its mouth is a circular loop mentioned above. Another such surface is placed in like tiffin ball structure. On applying Ampere's circuital law, to such surfaces with the same perimeter, we find that the left hand side of the equation 8.1 has not changed, but the right hand side is 0 and not mu naught I. Since no current passes through the surface of figure 8.1 B and C, so we have a contradiction. Calculated one way, there is a magnetic field at point P. Calculated another way, magnetic field at P is 0. By use of Ampere's circuital law, this law must be missing something. The missing term must be such that one gets the same magnetic field at point P no matter what surface is used. One can guess the missing term by looking carefully at figure 8.1C. Is there anything passing through the surface S between the plates of the capacitor? Yes, of course, the electric field. If the plates of the capacitor have an area A and total charge Q, the magnitude of the electric field E between the plates is Q by A epsilon naught. See equation 2.41. The field is perpendicular to the surface of S. It has the same magnitude over area of the capacitor plates and vanishes outside it. So what is the electric flux through the surface S? Using Gauss law, it is phi E is equal to EA, which is equal to QA upon epsilon naught A, which is finally equal to Q upon epsilon naught. Now, if the charge on the capacitor plate changes with time, there is a current I equals to dQ by dt. So that we have d phi upon dt is equal to dq upon dt epsilon naught, which is equal to 1 upon epsilon naught into dq upon dt. This implies that for consistency, epsilon naught into d phi upon dt is equal to I. This is the missing term in Ampere's circuital law. If we generalize this law by adding the total current carried by the conductors through the surface, another term which is phi naught times the rate of change of electric flux through the same surface, the total has the same value of current I for all surfaces. If this is done, there is no contradiction in the value of B obtained anywhere using generalized Ampere's law. B at the point P is non-zero no matter which surface is used for calculating it. B at a point outside the places is same as that at point M just inside as it should be. The current carried by conductor due to flow of charges is known as conduction current. The current given by the new term and is due to changing electric field, it is therefore called displacement current or Maxwell's displacement current. Figure 8.2 shows the electric and magnetic fields conduction of electric current due to flowing charges, but also the time rate of change of electric field. More precisely, the total current I is the sum of conduction current denoted by IC and displacement current denoted by ID. So we have I is equal to IC plus ID, which is equal to IC plus epsilon naught d phi E upon dt. In explicit terms, it means that outside the capacitor plates, we have only conduction current IC equals to I and no displacement current, that is ID equals to 0. On the other hand, inside the capacitor there is no conduction current, that is IC is equal to 0, and there is only displacement current, so that ID is equal to I. The generalized and correct Ampere's circuital law has the same form as equation 8.1 with one difference. The total current passing through any surface of which the closed loop is perimeter is the sum of conduction current and the displacement current. The generalized law is integration of B dot dl is equal to mu naught IC plus mu naught epsilon naught d phi E upon dt. This is known as Ampere-Maxwell law. In all respects, the displacement current has the same physical effects as the conduction current. In some cases, for example steady electric fields in conducting wire, the displacement current may be zero since the electric field E does not change with time. In other cases, for example, the charging capacitor above both conduction and displacement currents may be present in different regions of space. In most cases, they both may be present in the same region of space. As there exists no perfectly conducting or perfectly region of space insulating medium. Most interestingly, there may be large regions of space where there is no conduction current, but there is only a displacement current due to time-varying electric field. In such a region, we expect a magnetic field. The displacement current has literally far-reaching consequences. One thing we immediately notice is that the laws of electricity and magnetism are now more symmetrical. Faraday's law of induction states that there is an induced EMF equal to the rate of change of magnetic flux. Now, since the EMF between two plates 1 and 2 is the work done per unit charge, in taking it from 1 to 2, the existence of an EMF implies the existence of an electric field. So, we can rephrase Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction by saying that a magnetic field changing with time gives rise to an electric field. Then, the fact that an electric field changing with time gives rise to a magnetic field is the symmetrical counterpart and is a consequence of displacement current being source of magnetic field. Thus, time-dependent electric and magnetic field gives rise to each other. Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction and Ampere's Maxwell law give a quantitative expression of this statement, with the current being the total current. One very important consequence of this symmetry is the existence of electromagnetic waves, which we discuss qualitatively in next section. I'm skipping example 8.1 for you to solve it later, or you can pause the video and solve it right now. 8.3 Electromagnetic waves. 8.3.1 Sources of electromagnetic waves. How are electromagnetic waves produced? Neither stationary charges nor charges in uniform motion can be the sources of electromagnetic waves. The former produces only electrostatic fields, while the latter produces magnetic fields that, however, do not vary with time. It is an important result of Maxwell's theory that accelerated charges radiate electromagnetic waves. The proof is of basic result is beyond the scope of this book, but we can accept it on the basis of rough qualitative reasoning. Consider a charge oscillating with some frequency. An oscillating charge is an example of accelerating charge. This produces an oscillating electric field in space, which produces an oscillating magnetic field, which in turn is a source of oscillating electric field. In the preceding discussion, it might appear easy to test the prediction that light is an electromagnetic wave. We might think that all we needed to do was to set up an AC circuit in which current oscillates at the frequency of visible light, say yellow light. But alas, that is not possible. The frequency of yellow light is about 6 into 10 to the power 14 Hz, while the frequency that we get even with modern electronic circuit is hardly but about 10 to the power 11 Hz. This is why the experimental demonstration of electromagnetic wave had to come in low frequency region, as in the Hertz experiment. Hertz's successful experimental test of Maxwell's theory created a sensation and sparked off other important works in its field. Two important achievements of this connection: Calcutta, which is now Kolkata, succeeded in producing and observing electromagnetic waves of much shorter wavelength. His experiment, like that of Hertz, was confined to the laboratory. At around the same time, Guglielmo Macroni in Italy followed Hertz's experiment and succeeded in transmitting electromagnetic waves over distances of many kilometers. Macroni's experiment marks the beginning of the field of communication using electromagnetic waves. 8.3.2 Nature of electromagnetic waves. It can be shown from Maxwell's equation that electric and magnetic fields in electromagnetic wave are perpendicular to each other and to the direction of propagation. It appears reasonable, say, from our discussion, this displacement current. Consider figure 8.2. The electric field inside the plates of the capacitor is directed perpendicular to the plates. The magnetic field this gives rise to via displacement current is along the perimeter of the circle parallel to the capacitor plates. So, B and E are perpendicular in this case. This is a general feature. In figure 8.4, we show a typical example of plane electromagnetic wave propagating along the z direction. The electric field Ex is along the x axis and varies sinusoidally with z at a given time. The magnetic field By is along y axis and it again varies sinusoidally with z. The electric and magnetic field Ex and By are perpendicular to each other and to the direction of z of propagation. We can write Ex and Ey as follows. Ex is equal to E0 sine kz minus omega t. By is equal to B0 sine kz minus omega t. Here, k is related to the wavelength of lambda of the wave by the usual equation k is equal to 2 pi upon lambda.
and omega is the angular frequency. K is the magnitude of the wave vector for propagation vector, and its direction describes the direction of propagation of the wave. The speed of propagation of the wave is omega upon K. For Ex and Eby, the Maxwell equation one finds that omega is equal to Ck, where C is equal to 1 upon under root epsilon naught mu naught. The relation omega is equal to Ck is the standard one for waves. This relation is often written in terms of frequency as nu is equal to omega upon 2 pi and wavelength lambda is equal to 2 pi upon k. As 2 pi nu is equal to 2 pi c upon lambda, or nu lambda is equal to c. It is also seen from Maxwell equation that magnitude of electric and magnetic fields in an electromagnetic wave are related as B naught is equal to E naught upon C. We here make remark on some features of electromagnetic waves. They are self-sustaining oscillations of electric and magnetic fields in free space or vacuum. They differ from all the other waves we have studied so far. In respect to that, no material medium is involved in the vibrations of electric and magnetic fields. Sound waves in air are longitudinal waves of compression and rarefaction. The transverse elastic waves can also propagate in a solid, which is rigid and that resists shear. Scientists in the 19th century were so much used to this mechanical picture that they thought that there must be some medium pervading all the space and all the matter which responds to electric and magnetic field just as elastic medium does. They called this medium ether. They were so convinced to pass through a poisonous region of ether. We now accept that there is no such physical medium needed. The famous experiment of Michelson and Morley in 1887 demolished consequently the hypothesis of ether. Electric and magnetic fields oscillating in space and time can sustain each other with vacuum. But what if a material medium is actually there? We know that light and electromagnetic wave does not propagate through glass. For example, we have earlier seen that total electric and magnetic fields inside a medium are described in terms of permittivity epsilon and a magnetic permittivity mu. These replaces epsilon naught and mu naught in description to electric and magnetic fields in Maxwell's equations, with results that in a material magnetic permeability mu equal to 1 upon under root epsilon mu. Thus, the velocity of light depends on electric and magnetic properties of the medium. We shall see in the next chapter that refractive index of one medium with respect to the other is equal to the ratio of velocities of light in the two media. Velocity of electromagnetic waves in free space or vacuum is an important fundamental constant. It has been shown by experiments on electromagnetic waves of different wavelengths that this velocity is the same to within few meters per second, but of a value 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. The constancy of the velocity of electromagnetic waves in vacuum is so strongly supported by experiments that the actual value so well known now is that it used to define a standard of length. Namely, a meter is now defined as distance traveled by light in vacuum in a time 1 upon c seconds, which is equal to 2.99792458 into 10 to the power 8 per seconds. This has come of about following reasons. The basic unit of time can be defined very accurately in terms of some atomic frequency, that is frequency of light emitted by an atom in a particular process. The basic unit of length is harder to define as accurately as in a direct way. Earlier measurement converts to a value of about 2.9979246 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. Since C is such strongly fixed number, unit of length can be defined in terms of C and unit of time. Hertz not only showed the existence of electromagnetic waves but also demonstrated that waves which had wavelength 10 million times than the light waves could be diffracted, refracted and polarized. Thus, he conclusively established the wave nature of radiation. Further, he produced stationary electromagnetic waves and determined wavelength by measuring the distance between two consecutive nodes. Since the frequency of wave was known, he obtained the speed of wave using the formula
V is equal to nu. In fact, the electromagnetic waves are polarized, so can be easily seen in response of a portable AM radio to a broadcasting station. If an AM radio has a telescopic antenna, it responds to the electric part of the signal. When the antenna is turned horizontal, the signal will be greatly diminished. Some portable radios have horizontal antenna which are sensitive to the magnetic component of the electromagnetic wave. Such a radio must remain horizontal in order to receive the signal. In such cases, response also depends on the orientation of the radio with respect to the station. Do electromagnetic waves carry energy and momentum like other waves? Yes, they do. We have seen in chapter 2 that a region free of space with electric field E, there is an energy density of epsilon naught E square upon 2. Similarly, as seen in chapter 6, associated with a magnetic field B is a magnetic energy density of B square upon 2 mu naught. As electromagnetic wave contains both electric and magnetic fields, there is a non-zero energy density associated with it. Now consider a plane perpendicular to the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave. If there are only of this plane electric charges, they will be set and sustained in motion by electric and magnetic fields of the electromagnetic wave. The charges thus acquire energy and momentum from the waves. This just illustrates the fact that an electromagnetic wave carries energy and momentum. Since it carries momentum, an electromagnetic wave also exerts pressure called radiation pressure. If the total energy transferred to a surface is in time t is u, it can be shown that the magnitude of total momentum delivered to this surface is p is equal to u upon c. When the sun shines on your head, you feel the energy being absorbed from the electromagnetic waves. Your hands get warm. The electromagnetic waves also transfer momentum to your hand, but because C is very large, the amount of momentum transferred is extremely small and you do not feel the pressure. In 1903, American scientist Nichols and Hull succeeded in measuring radiation pressure of visible light and verified. It was found to be of order 7×10⁻⁶ Newton per meter square. Thus, on surface area of 10 cm square, the force due to radiation is only about 7×10⁻⁹ Newton. The great technological importance of electromagnetic waves stems from the capability to carry energy from one place to another. The TV, radio signals, skipping example 8.2 and 8.3 for you to solve it later, or you can pause the video and solve it right now. 8.4 as well. 8.5 as well. 8.4 Electromagnetic spectrum. At the time Maxwell predicted the existence of electromagnetic waves, the only familiar electromagnetic wave were the visible light waves. The existence of ultraviolet and infrared waves was barely established. By the end of 19th century, X-rays and gamma rays had also been discovered. We know that electromagnetic waves include the visible light waves, X-rays, gamma rays, radio waves, microwaves, ultraviolet and infrared waves. The classification of electromagnetic waves according to the frequency is the electromagnetic spectrum. There is no sharp division between one kind of wave and the next. The classification is based roughly on how the waves are produced or detected. We briefly describe these types of electromagnetic waves in the order of decreasing wavelengths. 8.4.1 Radio waves. Radio waves are produced by the accelerated motion of charges in conducting wires. They are used in radio and television communication systems. They are generally in the frequency from 500 kHz to about 1000 MHz. The AM or amplitude modulated bands is from 530 kHz to 1710 kHz. Higher the frequencies up to 54 MHz are used for shortwave bands. TV waves range from 54 MHz to 890 MHz. The FM or frequency modulated radio band extends from 88 MHz to 108 MHz. Cellular phones use radio waves to transmit voice communication in ultra-high frequency, that is UHF band. How these waves are transmitted and received is described in chapter 15. 8.4.2 Microwaves. Microwaves or short-length wavelength radio waves with frequency in gigahertz range are produced by special vacuum tubes called crystal guns, magnetrons and gun bodies. due to their short wavelengths, thus suitable for radar system used in aircraft navigation. Radar also provides the basis for speed guns used for time-fast balls, tennis serves and automobiles. Microwave ovens are an interesting domestic application of these waves. In such ovens, the frequency of microwaves is selected as to match the resonant frequency of water molecules so that energy from the waves is transferred efficiently to the kinetic energy of the molecules. This raises the temperature of any food containing water. 8.4.3 Infrared waves. Infrared waves are produced by hot bodies and molecules. This band lies adjacent to the low frequency or low wavelength end of the visible spectrum. Infrared waves are sometimes referred to as heat waves. This is because water molecules present in most of the materials readily absorb infrared waves. After absorption, their thermal motion increases, that is, they heat up and heat their surroundings. Infrared lamps are used in physical therapy. Infrared radiation also plays an important role in maintaining Earth's warmth or average temperature through the greenhouse effect. Incoming visible light is absorbed by Earth's surface and re-radiated as infrared radiations. This radiation is trapped by greenhouse gases such as carbon atoms. 8.4.4 Visible rays. It is the most familiar form of electromagnetic waves. It is the part of spectrum that is detected by human eye. It runs from about 4 into 10 to the power 14 Hz to about 7 into 10 to the power 14 Hz, or a wavelength range of about 700 to 400 nanometer. Visible light emitted or reflected from objects around us provides us information about the world. Our eyes are sensitive to this range of wavelengths. Different animals are sensitive to different range of wavelengths. For example, snakes can detect infrared waves, and a visible light range of many insects extends up to ultraviolet. 8.4.5 Ultraviolet rays. It covers wavelength ranging from about 4 into 10 to the power minus 7 meter down to 6 into 10 to the power minus 10 meter. Ultraviolet radiation is produced by special lamps and very hot bodies. The sun is an important source of ultraviolet radiations, but fortunately, most of it is absorbed in the ozone layer of the atmosphere at an altitude of about 40 to 50 kilometers. UV light in large quantities is harmful for humans. Exposure to UV radiation induces production of more melanin, causing tanning of the skin. UV radiation is absorbed by ordinary glass. Hence, one cannot get tanned or sunburned through glass windows. Welders wear special glass goggles or face masks with glass windows to protect their eyes from large amount plays a protective role, and hence its depletion by chlorofluorocarbon gas is a matter of international concern. 8.4.6 X-rays. Beyond the UV region of the electromagnetic spectrum lies the X-ray region. We are familiar with X-ray because of its medicinal applications. It covers the wavelength of about 10 to the power minus 8 meter down to 10 to the power minus 13 meter. One common way to generate X-rays is to bombard a metal target by high energy electrons. X-rays are used as a diagnostic tool in medicine and as a treatment for certain forms of cancer. Because of X-rays damage or destroy living tissues and organism, care must be taken to avoid unnecessarily or over exposure. 8.4.7 Gamma rays. They lie in the upper frequency range of the electromagnetic spectrum and have wavelengths of from about 10 to the power minus 10 meter to less than 10 to the power minus 14 meter. This higher frequency radiation is produced in nuclear reactions and is also emitted by radioactive nuclei. They are used in medicine to destroy cancer cells. Table 8.1 summarizes different types of electromagnetic waves, their production and detections. As mentioned earlier, the demarcation between different regions is not sharp as they are overlaps. I am leaving the summary for you to handle, and you can get a brief view of all the chapter, and switching over to points of ponder, which is very important for the AIM section, which is not presently held but may be of use for NEET examination for tricky questions as well. So coming to points to ponder. Number 1. The basic difference between various types of electromagnetic waves lies in their wavelength or frequency, since all of them travel through vacuum with the same speed. Consequently, the waves differ considerably in their modes of interaction with matter. Number 2. Accelerated charged particles radiate electromagnetic waves. The wavelength of electromagnetic wave is often correlated with the characteristic size of system that radiates. Thus, gamma radiation having wavelength of about 10⁻¹⁴ meter to 10⁻¹⁵ meter typically originate from atomic nucleus. X-rays are emitted from heavy atoms. Radio waves are produced by accelerating electrons in a circuit. A transmitting antenna can most efficiently radiate waves having a wavelength of about atomic size. Number 3. The oscillating fields of an electromagnetic wave can accelerate charges and can produce oscillating currents. Therefore, an apparatus designed to detect electromagnetic waves is based on the fact. Hertz's original receiver worked in exactly this way. The same basic principle is utilized in practically all modern receiving devices. High-frequency electromagnetic waves are detected by other means based on physical effects they produce on interacting with matter. Number 4. Infrared rays with frequencies lower than those of visible light vibrate only the electrons but entire atoms or molecules of a substance. This vibration increases the internal energy and consequently the temperature of the substance. That is why infrared rays are often referred to